I've often wondered why was one person happy, one sad, one rich, another poor, and the other one sick, and then the other one healthy. Hi, my name is Roger Kevion. What were the real causes of people's sickness? Why do some people find their purpose in life at a very young age, and others self-sabotage their personal dreams? My quest for deeper answers got stronger when I lost my mom to cancer, and 1 year later, I lost my dad. The doctors never did find the real cause of my dad's death, even after 4 to 5 years of testing. This was the time I chose to study metaphysics, just to find those evasive answers and deeper meaning about healing. It was at this time that I chanced upon Gregory Joseph, a healer for 36 years now. I could not believe how humble this man was when I first met him. Gregory has facilitated in the healing of people with all types of cancers. I also discovered he's helped a 6-year-old boy, a child, if you will, with degenerative bone disease. He's 100% healthy. This was 20 years ago. He's also helped others with anxiety and panic attacks, multiple sclerosis, and many, many other illnesses have been healed with Gregory's help.
I was dealing with something I couldn't see, feel, taste, or touch. And as a contractor, putting wood into a wall, and it stays there, and it's permanent, and I can see it, I can feel it, I can taste it, and I can touch it. Anything beyond that was something I didn't want to know about. But one day, when I was out searching for a way to save my life, I realized that it wasn't about some woo-woo mystical thing. It was about ancient knowledge that has been taken from us over the years. It's been stripped from us. And all we really need to do is to learn that knowledge. Really turned my head was when I found out that we can learn to heal with our minds. It is, in fact, our minds that are healing us or making us ill. Not just our conscious mind, but our subconscious minds.
We have known that alternative healing methods have existed for centuries, and it's always been within our reach. We all have this light within us. It's high time to invite this incredible energy in and be friends with it. We are in a time in history that it's not enough to just know about healing, but it's time to know how. Come join us and learn what's really at the heart of healing. Gregory, welcome to Canada.
It's good to be in Canada.
All right.
So lush and beautiful here.
It's nice. We love it. It's calm and it's beautiful. Mm-hmm. Anyways, I want to get straight into it. I want to ask you, how did you get in to become a healer?
I started a long time ago in my father's restaurant. You'd think because we're Greek and he owned a restaurant that I'd be in the restaurant business. But my passion was in carpentry. I just loved playing with wood. I couldn't believe that I could play with wood and people actually paid me for it. And I had the great fortune to work with a master carpenter who was a perfectionist, who learned his trade at the expense of his life if he wasn't doing it perfect. His gift to me was that perfectionism, that attitude. And through that attitude, well, he never let me do any carpentry because he was a perfectionist.
Okay.
But the gift that he gave me was that attitude of perfection. And because of that, I went on to be a master carpenter. I realized at a very young age that I was better than most of the carpenters around, that I could really perform. And it wasn't long after that I began building homes. I built homes, very large custom homes in Colorado, New York, and California, up to 19,000 square feet.
Wow.
A lot of people working for me, a lot of responsibilities. I was on top of the world. I loved it. It was, my life was set. I was on schedule to be a millionaire.
Okay.
Then I got some terrible news. My wife was not feeling well. We went to the doctor and she got diagnosed with a brain tumor. And they gave her 2 weeks to live at best after this operation. She actually went another 11 years. And this gave me some time. I actually went self-medicated for a while. I went into somewhat of a depression. And luckily, one of my neighbors noticed. And she introduced me to a fellow who then became my teacher and spiritual guide for the next 22 years, Alexander Everett. And through him, I discovered people who could heal. And these people were in other countries. So I wound up going to India, sitting at the feet of the masters, Sri Satya Sai Baba's ashram. Anybody that I heard of that was doing amazing healing work and really doing something different, not just making people feel good, but really healing them. Sri Satya Sai Baba, Guru Ma, Guru Amma, the hugging guru. I studied under Jasmine, a seer in Thailand. And Diana Manilova, a Russian psychic, amazing qualities in these people. They can read things and see what's going on in your body and allow you then, because of that awareness, to do some healing work with it. I was too late for my wife. She, because of these Eastern philosophies, she had a lot of difficulty taking this information in. And so a lot of people, though, lived because of what she had done. When I went back to Jasmine to ask her, I said, Jasmine, why did she have to suffer so much? And Jasmine, who could not speak English, I mean, she had no lead into this at all, told me everything about my family. So I asked her that question. And she says, it's easy. She said, you were a macho builder. You were pretty rough on people, you know, the way you were. And now you're this intuitive master healer. And her mission was accomplished.
Which was what, her mission?
To make me a healer.
Isn't that something?
Yeah. Wow. So we think some things happen for one reason in our lives, but then we find out that they happened for another reason entirely. So thinking that she had just died wasn't the answer. She had completed her mission. It was her time to go. I'm sure there were other things that she accomplished. Women in her family were kind of tough on the other women. And my daughter loves her daughter. So my wife took on all that karma.
Okay.
It was really an amazing sacrifice on her part.
Wow.
That was her mission. She accomplished it. And I have to say, I'm quite happy about this. I wasn't happy at the time. But with this deeper understanding of these other worlds, it actually gave me the incentive to go further into those worlds. I had to find out more.
Okay, so you became a full-time healer then?
Full-time healer. I stopped building entirely. This is what I do.
Wow.
Yeah. So the people's lives, I say, well,
did I help them heal? Now, I want to clear something up, too.
Sure.
I don't actually heal people. You have to heal yourself. What I do is open the door.
Okay.
So I have methods and means. This is just knowledge. And when we bring this knowledge up to our conscious knowing, all of a sudden, yourself, the energy that's already manifest within you, does the healing. Their ability to heal that's already manifest within them. And I just bring that to light. And yes, it is profound. It's difficult. We maybe should call ourselves something different than healers. We don't heal somebody else. Simply open the door.
Okay.
You have to heal yourself.
But 20 years ago, I originally went to him because I was suffering incredible postpartum depression after my second daughter was born. I don't know why, but I didn't feel connected to her. I don't think she felt connected to me. I was just depressed. I didn't want to get out of bed. It was something I'd never felt before, and I didn't know what to do about it. I didn't want to go on drugs, and counselors weren't going to, they didn't know what to do with me. So in one session with Greg, he did this work on my heart and opened up my heart chakra, and then he reconnected our bond between us. Felt like a beam of light that was reconnected between my little baby girl and me. And I'm telling you, it was instant. She was in the other room. She was screaming and crying like she always did. And suddenly she stopped crying. And when the session was over, I went out there and she just wanted me to hold her. She never wanted that before. And from then on, it was just absolute love between us. We're like best friends today. She's 20 years old, super successful student at San Diego State. So how could I ever thank Greg enough for that?
For the past 10 years, Master Healer Greg Joseph has been instrumental in helping me overcome things that limited my abilities, my physical, emotional, mental state. May have shown that had limitations or challenge hung up over what people said, opinions about me that made me think that I was less of a person. I had many challenges, both physically and emotionally, related to my family, in particular my father, many father issues that plagued me, and including my father's bakery, where I blame my father and my father's bakery on a lower back injury that has plagued me since the age of 18. I can tell you that over the last 10 years, Greg has shown me that I am the creator. I am the one that creates the emphasis on my lower back or healing or my father as a good man or my father as a bad person who may have caused this problem. I can tell you as well, both personally and professionally, Greg's teachings allow you to look at how you conduct your behavior, how you assess yourself, whether or not you are tuned into how you are conveying your persona to others. And what I've found is that Greg has given me relief from pain, relief from stress, relief from feeling that I am less than others. Growing up in a family and learning of my place in the world, I felt less of a person. What Greg has shown me is how the lessons that I have gained through my challenges, through my stories, and how one thing relates to another. In other words, what I do professionally is how I conduct myself personally. And things that I may find as a challenge personally that I overlay in my professional life can be healed, cured, mitigated, resolved instantaneously. That teaching alone and the simplicity of what Greg, the Master Healer, provides me really helps me to accelerate my ability to heal, my ability to excel. I felt that I had limitations in the gym where I feel very comfortable and I'm relaxed when I'm lifting weight. Having this lower back injury used to cripple me from really excelling in the gym, pushing myself, really ensuring that I'm hitting my potential in the gym, and shedding the concern over fear of injury, fear of failure. I focused on me, thanks to Greg Joseph's teaching. And so to see myself through others' eyes, or to reflect on how I conduct myself. There's an exercise in particular that he has provided me that I use at night, where I reflect on what I did during the day, not to be critical, but to really review, rewind, and be with that image to ensure that I am rewarding success rather than focusing on failure. I am a better man today, looking at my father and loving him more rather than thinking that he has been an anchor or a challenge to my success or my physical being. I have excelled professionally, ensuring that a particular person, my boss, or someone in my upline is not the person that controls my destiny in a professional life. That there is no such thing as a contentious meeting. It is a meeting that I create, that I conduct well before it is done.
My vision of this is people are running around, running here, running there, trying to find their purpose, looking outside of themselves instead of inward. The first stage of any knowingness is becoming aware of where you are in the moment. And when we become aware of ourselves, maybe we're already in our purpose. It happens in so many different ways. A couple of good ways, like really to find your own purpose, or to find out what you came here to do. You might think of yourself when you were 12 years old. Because when you're a child, there's no inhibitors into what it is that you would really love to do. So somebody says, what do you want to do when you grow up? So I want to be a fireman. I want to be a doctor. Or I want to be, and most children choose services that help other people. It's kind of interesting because they're so, their heart is so open, and what they'd love to do is to help other people. If you could go back to when you were 12 years old and think about what it was that really lit you up, that really, you know, stoked your fire, and you really wanted to be that, chances are pretty good that's what you came here to do.
I believe so. It was a hockey player.
Yeah. So, you know, and when you think about it, many of the major masters, the main masters, like you talk about Jesus or Buddha, they had their turning point right about that time in their lives when they actually knew who they were and they began their teachings. So it's a really good time in life to go back and check and see what's going on. Another way you could do it is go out in nature. Nature's so beautiful and quiet. I wish people could experience this beautiful setting that we have here, and this lake and the trees around it. Trees, the lake, and nature, they don't fuss about what they're here for. They know. The tree doesn't want to be a flower. The flower doesn't want to be a tree. The rose doesn't want to be a dandelion, and vice versa. They are perfectly content in what it is and who it is that they are. That's funny to say who they are. But relating that back into ourselves, if we would just take a look at ourselves and we start to understand who we are rather than what everybody thinks we should be. Have you ever gone to an amusement park and you see one of those little circle rides, you know, and there's a beautiful, there's a sleek looking jet, there's an old tank, and there's a jalopy, and there's a sand dune, everything falling apart, and the little boy wants to get in the old jalopy and the father's trying to put him in the slick jet. This is the first step in a process that stops us from knowing who we are. This is something that strips the will, because we've taken away something so tremendously important for that child in that moment of wanting them to be better in what we think is what they would love, rather than their own choice. And if we grow up making our own choices, we really don't have much of an idea that says, I don't know who I am. We have an idea that says, this is what lights me up now. Here's my choice. This is what lights me up today. This is my choice. How I do everything is my purpose. So if I'm able to make choice, if I'm able to be aware, if I'm able to go back and see what it is that really makes me happy, I'll never walk another day of my life. I talked about nature a little while ago. Stepping out in nature is one way to really clear one's mind. Especially now, we've gotten to a certain age in life and we've had so many programs given to us. We've had so much teaching to take us outside of ourselves that if we can go someplace and be very quiet and learn, you know, meditate, you know, I call it, what I learned it was called centering. So I don't pick something to meditate on. I simply allow myself to go wherever it is that I need to go.
Okay.
So I leave my conscious thinking behind and go into what I would call my unconscious, superconscious, or I am presence. Some people actually call this the God within. And there's many, many ways. The meditation process itself, called centering, it actually uses your brain to get you to a place where your brain doesn't be used anymore. So it's a neat thing. So your brain doesn't feel like it has to catch up or be there.
Okay, so it sounds like if I got to be persistent.
Sure.
Because the brain can talk for a long time just because of the program we have.
Yeah, okay. Absolutely. Becoming very focused in what you're doing is one way to do it. I was going to tell you something just a few minutes ago. It was whatever thoughts you have, command them to go to the center of your head. It's an interesting process. And you just, even the thought that says, let's put these thoughts to the center of my head, put that in there too. It'll come again, don't worry. Brain's, like you say, very persistent in keeping full of noise. While you're throwing all of these things to the center of your head, concentrate on your breath, concentrate on your breathing. Now, we've done several exercises since I've been here.
Yeah.
And we seem to know this, but we seem to forget in our everyday lives. Just stop and take some breathing. Go into yourself, like a great process to do this. You say, every hour takes 60 seconds. No matter what you're doing, you're talking to somebody in the middle of a conversation, most people will not notice. And take a moment, put all of your thoughts to the center of your head. Concentrate on your breathing. Guess what? It brings your attention in toward your heart. I tell a lot of people, you really want to know what your purpose is and what your projects in life is to be? Ask your heart. Ask your heart and then wait for the answer. Don't let your brain interfere. Okay, so you say, I'm listening with my heart, and I'm going to speak with my heart.
Yeah, I felt that a lot, but I've never listened to it. I don't listen to it enough.
Well, we have what we might call our senior commitments. Okay, I've got to go make money. For heaven's sakes, I've got to look good. So I can't go off on a little tangent here. I've got to be right about certain things, yeah. I've got to do whatever it takes to get ahead, rather than just to say, I would love to do something that I love to do right now.
Yeah.
Like if you were to say, if I were to ask you, and I would tell anybody this, you say, what could you do today by yourself with nobody else involved that would bring you joy?
Yeah, about lots of things.
See, most people can't come up with many.
Yeah.
You're quite balanced in that. You really know what makes you happy, what rings your bell. I see beautiful flowers all over. I see an impeccable place to live. I see harmony and peace, and that's something that you are really tuned into. You know what brings you peace. And that's an important, really important thing to know. Could that be your only purpose? Well, if you do everything peacefully, that could be your purpose. It's not some esoteric thing out there that you have to wait for Einstein or somebody else to tell you from their grave. You absolutely have it in you right now. So you go back, you're 12 years old, you go into nature, meditate, quiet your mind, ask yourself the question, a really simple thing to do. What is it that I should be doing in life? Now, there's another way you can ask that question and get the answer. And know that it isn't your brain messing with you, okay? Because it will do that. It will do that, okay? And so you could, just before you go to bed, sit at the edge of your bed, pour a nice glass of water, and ask a question, okay? Drink half the glass of water and put it on, back on the table, go to sleep. And when you wake up, drink the other half of the glass of water. Like you could say, what is the meaning of my life? What is it that I should be doing in my life? That's an important question, an empowering question. Not what's the meaning of life? I mean, where's that going to get you? Mm-hmm. Ask a question that your unconscious mind, or even in a conscious state, you could answer. Very important. And you do that, and you could get the answer the very next morning.
Mm-hmm. I've known Greg Joseph for over 10 years, and I have to tell you, he's one of the most compassionate and sensitive people I've ever met. And I mean sensitive in really a good way. He's able to just get a feel for what's going on with me when I'm talking to him and really just address the specific issues in such non-threatening ways. It's able to just transform me. One session I did with Greg was really powerful. In only a few moments, we were able to get down to some very deeply buried, unconscious root causes for behaviors that had just been shutting me down for quite some time. And we could identify them, we could see where they came from, we can quickly acknowledge them, and then we're able to replace them with a better set of programming that has freed me up tremendously.
It's really hard to describe. It was very simple and elegant and kind of effortless. And before I worked with him, I was feeling really like everything was upside down. That was happening to me, everything was kind of backfiring. And it was going on for a while. Really strange. And everything I was doing to alleviate it was literally backfiring. So it was fascinating to me as I work with a lot of subconscious work. And I do a lot of amazing kind of internal work myself. And it was just nothing was working. And I didn't feel like myself. That was the worst part. It's hard to describe. It just didn't feel like me. I would say to people, this doesn't feel like me. I don't know what's happening to me. I don't relate to what's happening to me or how I'm feeling. And I kind of knew the moment it started. And anyway, so when I worked with Gregory, we didn't even have to talk about all that. It was actually quite simple and elegant how I worked, as I said. And what's the results afterwards, how I feel now, it almost sounds too simple, but it's everything to me. I feel restored to myself. I feel like me. I feel like me again. And I feel like I can take action. I can do things that are actually, you know, go back to the things that have always worked for me, and they work now. So, yeah, I feel like me. It's profound. It's beautiful. He is a healer for healers, and so appreciated. Thank you so much, Gregory.
Don't remember, I was at a spiritual retreat. It was my first time meditating, and all these body symptoms came up. I was so tense. My neck was locked up. My back was locked up. And he said, I think I can help you with that. And I haven't stopped working with Greg since then. Anytime that I know I need enlightenment, I need to let go of emotional stuff, I have physical stuff that I'm in pain over, he's usually the first person I talk to. I remember one time I walked into, he actually walked into my house, and he looked at me and he said, you don't even look like you. My face had blown up this big. I was having a severe allergic reaction to poison oak, and I was pregnant, and I was miserable. And in like 2 seconds, he nailed what it was for me. He worked his mojo magic. The next day I woke up, the swelling had gone down so incredulously by way over 50%, but I knew that was going to happen. I wasn't even shocked. It was just like, phew, thank goodness. So it's never mattered what the thing was that was wrong with me. He was always able to pinpoint, and still is, what I needed, when I needed it, and quickly. That's the thing I love about it most. And he'll also hit me with the hard truth a lot and ask some really tough questions. But in the end, I'm always grateful. So thank you, Greg Joseph, for all your magic over the years. And I hope I won't need you soon.
All right. Good morning once again, Gregory. I'm thankful you're here this morning, and I want to get right into the next question that I want to ask you. Is in your mind, why is it that people, what's the number one reason, I should say, that people get sick in this world?
Well, one of the key factors that I talk about a lot is loving yourself. And if you love yourself, you won't criticize yourself. You won't judge yourself. You'll find things in your life that you could say, yes, I found another one. I can take care of this. A lot of times we have a barometer, an inner barometer. We would call that our I am presence, the thing that knows everything and all that is. And this guides, helps to guide us through life. And we have ideas about how it is that we speak, how we should act, how we should do things. The short answer, I would say, is self-punishment. And why would you do that? For example, I say to somebody, well, when did you create this illness? Or why? And they will go into this idea that says, oh, it's not my fault, you know. And I say, well, we're not concerned about that it's your fault. But why is it that you decided to punish yourself? Now, the crime will fit how deeply you think you should be punished. The punishment fits whatever crime you committed. You might have stepped on the dog's tail, and you love dogs, so you might punish yourself by getting into a car accident. You might punish yourself by creating a cold. You might, depending on the severity of what it is that you think you committed, deserves punishment. Let's take the example of something really under the table, because you really don't even notice it. It's something you think you're doing for a good intention, but it really is not dealing in the truth in the moment. It's called a lie. And so we say, well, don't tell your brother about this because it may hurt his feelings. So you've just decided to lie. Now, think about in our society what has happened with people who have got caught in lie.
You know? Yeah, we get punished.
Oh, boy, do we ever. The President of the United States, he was impeached for lying, not for the acts that he did. Right. He lied about them.
Yeah.
So this is a very powerful force inside of us, and we have what we would call, we're all familiar with something called our I am presence, our inner guidance system, our unconscious mind, how we want to call that, knows the truth. And you tell this little lie, and it says, hey, you lied. You know, now society has also taught us lying is bad. Maybe that's bad, good, right, wrong. These are subjective kind of measures, and we should be really careful about them. If I was lying about saving somebody in my house because somebody was trying to hurt them, they say, are they in your house? And I say, no. Well, is that good or bad or right or wrong? It's the intention behind what we're doing that really makes the difference. Now, if we've told this lie and we've gotten away with it, okay, the only person left to punish you is yourself. And you will determine how harshly to punish yourself. And that goes all the way up to every, what might be a debilitating disease, just stubbing your toe, creating what most people would call a terminal disease. All of these things are within the realm of punishment.
Did you not have a story about a hockey player or something like
that?
Oh,
yeah.
That you can share?
Sure. This young fellow was brought to me, and he had casts on both of his legs. He was told he'll never play hockey again. And we wanted to find out what happened. So it turned out that he was a battered child. And his way of communicating with people was by fighting. And his life was pretty tough. So when he fought, he really hurt people.
Okay.
And when he got this contract, he was one of the youngest people ever to get a contract to play hockey. He was still in high school. That's just unheard of.
Yeah.
And that night, after he got the contract, or he was told he was going to get the contract, he went out and partied. And got in a very bad car accident and blew out both of his knees. He will never play hockey, according to medical doctors.
So it came back to him. What he was doing kind of came back to him in an accident for him.
Yeah, his internal barometer said, I know I have done all of these deeds. I don't deserve all of this greatness.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and this then, wow, what a harsh punishment he gave himself.
Yeah.
When it could have been something that he could, if we had just caught it ahead of time, could have been something to say, wow, now it's time to say, I forgive myself. Now it's time to say, I love myself. Not
what
punish.
What I seem to be hearing is that you have to be aware that that's why the accident happened. That most people never see that in a lifetime.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Like with this young boy, if we could have reached him before he had judged himself, before he had criticized himself and decided unconsciously, these are unconscious thoughts, okay, that he should be punished, maybe he could have been playing hockey today.
So what you're saying is that an event like this on an unconscious level, we can attract cancer or multiple sclerosis or degenerative bone disease or any type of disease for that matter.
Absolutely. This is how powerful we are. I did work with a woman who had multiple sclerosis, and after some, I actually had kind of a vision with her, and I explained the vision to her, and she knew what it meant. And she was a devout in her religion, which did not condone abortion. And she had had an abortion. And because she had had an abortion, and she did not tell her immediate family members, okay, she went about punishing herself. That inner clock inside of her was trained. Now, this is a program. This isn't an innate thing that we learned that we can't have an abortion. This is something that people decide upon as right, wrong, good, bad. That's why that realm of thinking is so dangerous.
Okay, it's a thought.
Yes, it's just a thought, correct. So I said, well, why did you punish her? We got to the point where she agreed she was punishing herself. So why multiple sclerosis? Again, this is our power. Her aunt had multiple sclerosis, and she was her caretaker. She knew the progression. She knew how it started. She knew how it manifests, because in the presence of that, your higher selves connect, and you absolutely know how this works. And her inner consciousness chose that particular idea called multiple sclerosis. Now, notice I didn't call it an illness. It's an idea.
Yeah.
Okay.
Idea.
That she manifests within herself with the power that we actually have to heal, working in reverse.
Why are people more addicted to pain than pleasure?
This is a real good one. There's positive addictions and negative addictions. How about being addicted to joy?
That would be nice, yeah.
That would be nice, like a positive addiction. Why have an addiction? We're talking more emotional, spiritual, mental, physical addictions rather than, for example, drug addictions or something of this nature. That's another ballgame. But rather to say a negative addiction might be, oh, the world's awful and then you die. That's a negative addiction.
Yeah.
Everything happens to me. That's a negative addiction.
Mm-hmm.
And you're actually proclaiming with the power inside you that that is going to be so. Now, why would people still want to do this? It's a command that you're actually giving to the universe to create this problem or this thing that you're creating, you know, to prove that you're right. It's one of our senior commitments in our brain. Our brain likes to be right. And it would rather be right than win. If we're doing things that we don't love to do, if we've never found what our real genius talent is, and this is one of the things we really want people to get here today, that is, find your genius. If you find your genius, you'll never work another day of your life. If you found the talent that's within it, you'll be joyful and happy, and there will be emotions, right? There will be feelings, there will be things that you like to enjoy occurring for you.
Mm-hmm.
If you're in a job that you hate every day, you hate the job, you anesthetize yourself. Something that evokes some kind of emotion, because the rest is dead.
Mm-hmm.
Like we've really lost our zest, our connection. We become disconnected. And when that starts to occur, we start creating illness. The way it happens. So we're not connected anymore to the flow of life. And it takes a good jolt for us. Rather than feel nothing, we feel pain.
Okay, but the pain and the pleasure, what's the correlation between us wanting to attract that pain way more than pleasure? Give me another explanation on that, because there's something missing for me.
You know, I think of the times I've been in pain and how pervasive it was.
Yeah.
It took all of my attention. Just when my wife passed, for example, there was a lot of emotional and mental pain.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought of nothing else. It totally consumed me. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Now let's flip the coin and say, wow, I just met the love of my life, and everything is going beautiful. The trees are growing faster, the flowers are blooming prettier, everything looks beautiful.
Yeah.
We adopt an entire different way of looking at things. It's a choice, isn't it?
It's a choice, yeah.
Most of us don't realize it's not something that just happens to us. We really have to create it. And it's a double-edged sword, like fear and excitement. It's the first stage of healing. The first stage of change is being aware.
Yeah.
So I'm making that choice again. The outward centrifugal force, love, is called the male energy. So just by definition, love is not the receiving thing. It's the giving thing. Okay? It's an outward centrifugal force. Now watch this. This is difficult. That's love.
What?
Yeah.
Okay, no.
An outward centrifugal force qualified for the smack. And this is love. Hey, how you doing? That's love. An outward centrifugal force qualified with compassion and care.
Wow, that's powerful.
You see, it could understand, help us to understand why people might stay in an abusive place. That's what I would call, or most people might call, a negative addiction.
Yeah.
Okay? Because it produces results that, for the most part, create more pain, misery, and despair.
Wow. Yeah. Thank you very much for this.
This has been about a decade that I've known him. And I think back to when we met. Oh my gosh. I was so wounded. I was so disconnected from myself and everyone else. I was more like a shell of a person, not so much here. And when I worked with him, just even the first time, it was amazing. He awakened something in my soul that allowed me to bring my gifts back and bring my light back, and everything changed from that moment on. And I've worked with him multiple times over the years, and it just keeps getting better. You know, it's one of those things where he is an amazing healer. He is so kind and so loving, and he gets some really incredible results.
My name's Adrienne Bailey. I was having excruciating ovarian pain, and I had to stop a couple of times while I was driving because the pain was so painful. And so I went to the emergency room, and I was there for 6 hours. They did an ultrasound. They did a CT scan. They told me that I had 3 fibroids. One was bleeding. And they told me to go see my primary doctor. And I did that after like two weeks. And then I told Gregory that, in the meantime, I had told Gregory that I was in pain, and he did some healing work on me. And by the time I went back to the doctor, there was nothing there. And now I have no pain down there at all. The pain was very painful. It felt like labor pains. So I'm grateful to Gregory for all of his help and his healing work.
I'm Nathalie Chapon, celebrity stylist and image consultant to some of the most highly acclaimed transformational leaders of our time. So I wanted to share with you a little bit about Gregory Joseph today and my experience working with Gregory. He is one of the most intuitive and powerful healers I've ever come across, and I've worked with many. He's so generous of his energy and knowledge and wisdom and power. And I was so impressed with him that I even took him on to be the designated healer on my retreats. I lead international retreats to France called Divinely Feminine, where I take women shopping in Paris. We do a photo shoot in Paris, and then we go to the south of France to follow in the footsteps of Mary Magdalene. It's a very powerful retreat. It's very beautiful. It's very transformational, and a lot of things come up for our clients. So not only did I have such a good experience in my own healing, you know, releasing old negative beliefs and energetic patterns, and, you know, he's helped me really rewire so much in my energetic body and in my life, that I really wanted my participants, the ladies that come on my retreats, my clients, to have his expert guidance and support during the retreat, so that whatever comes up for them, they could get support in real time, get energy clearing, negative belief clearing. And it's made a huge difference. He's masterful. He is knowledgeable. The breadth of his knowledge and expertise is wide. And he's able to really, because he's so intuitive, he's really able to kind of hone in on what's really going on for you and very quickly clear, transform, heal, in a very powerful and long-lasting manner.
You mentioned one time in one of your articles or one of your cassettes that it says, miracles are not performed by God for man, but by man for God. Can you elaborate for us on this?
It's an idea of how God is presented to us in our hearts. So we could look at God as a person or a being, which would mean this whole theory about, you know, you start with some dust in space and eventually becomes Earth, and eventually there's some little crawly thing that develops arms and legs. And then we're here. And that's one theory. And then there's another one, that there's a higher source that created us. And if you're kind of smirking at either one of those, because both of them leave us in a bit of a lurch.
Mm-hmm.
There's holes and dots in either one. If we're sitting here and we're saying God is out there somewhere, then where?
Yeah, because it's not a tangible thing.
Yeah. We can look at God as a being in the sky or some other place. I don't know where that would be, that we worship. And incidentally, this being judges you, sends you to institutions to pay money to, calls you a sinner. Okay, is it really this God calling you these things? Do you see?
Yes.
We can create miracles. We have a miracle of birth. Everybody pretty much agrees with that.
Yeah.
Okay, and did we not do that? Did God do that? Or did you?
We did.
Yeah. If I go up into an empty lot, and I say, I'm going to build a house there. I've been a builder.
Right.
And when I'm done, and I walk away from that empty lot, there is a house there. That's creation.
Right.
You say, well, yeah, well, you bought the wood, you bought the, you know, you put the subcontractors together, you arranged the whole thing to get it done.
Mm-hmm.
None of that would have happened had I not had the creative thought.
Of course.
So did I actually do it? Or did I use what I call God, which would be the all and the everything? Now, when I have this all and the everything, it takes out judgment, it takes out criticism. And yet we've been trained to live this way. And under the guise of calling it God, even people go to war. My God's better than yours. My God's right. Your God's wrong.
Right.
Who told them?
Yeah. Yeah.
It's like we talked about the meaning of love, that you can have love qualified with chaos, or you could have love qualified with harmony.
Absolutely, yes.
Yeah. Whose creation is that?
Ours.
Yeah, so this is a game that's been played for centuries and centuries called, there's somebody out there that's judging you.
Right.
In fact, you were born a sinner.
Yes, of course. Yeah, right. That's for a long time.
Yeah, isn't it something?
Yeah.
So why would somebody, when you're born, tell you you're less than or more than something else. This reminds me of something. There was an argument in a church in Colorado because they were going to move the church to another location, and they're arguing back and forth so much. Somebody pulled a knife on somebody, and then it was gone, of course. And the reason was, it's like, we can't move this, you know, church. This is sacred ground. And somebody chimed up and said, this was a parking lot 15 years ago. Why would you call this ground sacred and the ground we're even sitting on right now not sacred? Mm-hmm. What makes it sacred? Who did that? Mm-hmm. God tell you? In the Zen, they would say, everything is nothing. Okay, so you don't even know this is a chair until you identify it as a chair. Mm-hmm. It's just an object. Yeah. And if everybody agrees that it's a chair, we'll probably have a pretty good track.
Okay, so why is the word God so controversial to the world? There's wars that go,
yeah,
according to their God or my God or my religion.
Yeah, this is a sad game. It's called the right-wrong game. I'm right, you're wrong. Your God's not good, your God's, you know, bitter, my God's worse. However it comes out, it's called separation.
It is.
And separation, fear, leads to what? Anxiety, anger, frustration, which leads to what? Does it lead to joy, harmony, and peace? Does it lead to treating each other with respect and knowledge? Mm-hmm. What are we really doing in the name of God? We're using this name, undefinable by many, definable by some, never agreed upon by all, okay, to wage war against each other, to wage war against each other, to keep each other in fear. It's one of the most prolific ways to control people, is to get them afraid.
Yes.
So if you've been born a sinner, you're not whole and complete, then what are you? I would tell you, you are perfect and complete in every way. Mm-hmm. And how you use that perfection and completeness is totally your creation.
Yeah, I agree.
Ah, so if I'm creating something and you're creating something, just like we're even doing right now, we've created something together. Mm-hmm. And Shobha, who's filming us now, she's creating this too. All of us somehow created us here together. We've shown that to each other through so many what we would call synchronicities, mind-blending thoughts. We all come up at the same time with the same thing. Mm-hmm. While we're thinking something and we all immediately act upon it, this has been happening since we got here.
Absolutely.
So when I say, I look at God as the all and the everything, we're connected. That includes the air between us. It's not separating us, it's part of our body. Mm-hmm. Our bodies don't end in our skin. That's just a membrane between this inner body and that inner body. Mm-hmm. This inner body, and that outer body. We're all connected intrinsically, and this is how I would like myself to see God.
Okay.
It makes more sense to me. Let's look at something that doesn't make so much sense.
Okay.
Okay. We all came from Adam and Eve.
Okay.
Oh, how do you explain the races? How do you explain all the different, beautiful and amazing people on this earth? Completely different.
Completely different color.
Size, shape, color, yeah. Ideals, everything completely different. There is a train of thought that says, well, there was a point of creation. We were created by, oh, let's call them extraterrestrials, okay? Let's just call them beings of light that we've not met yet. Or at one time, we're actually a part of, and maybe a part of right now. Mm-hmm. And they created these beings called humans. And all of the men were called Adams, and all of the women were called Eves. And it was such a great experiment that beings from other dimensions, galaxies, came in to participate. And maybe that's what created all the different races. Mm-hmm. It makes a bit more logical sense.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. In the realm of possibilities, who knows? Bottom line is, in that period of time, I wasn't there. Mm-hmm. Okay? So I can only know what I know. And what I think I know, or what I know that I think, better stated, yeah, is that the latter to me makes more sense. Right. That we have a context. This context has every single resource we need to create whatever it is we'd like to create. The active ingredients resides within us, including creating our own bodies. Mm-hmm. Created in our own image. Mm-hmm. Here's the image that our thought form has for ourself and has created me in this image. Mm-hmm. Is this God? Did God create me? Did I create God? Did God create the miracle? Did I create the miracle? Well, I could ask, like to ask questions too that maybe we could answer. And you could say in one sense, who cares? Okay? And get along with everybody. Say, wow, I hear what you're saying. That's okay. We're both looking for peace and cooperation and harmony. But somebody says, yeah, but mine's better and you'd better do this or you're wrong. Mm-hmm. And I'll fight you for it. Just yeah. Choices, aren't they?
Yeah.
What would you want to create? I've traveled the world, and I'll tell you, there are beautiful aunts, uncles, sisters, brothers, children, grandmothers, grandfathers, okay. Everywhere.
Yeah.
And they want the same thing that you just said. Yeah. It's up to us to create it. Create it by being harmonious, by being nurturing, by being loving in a way that's qualified such that we extol the beautiful genius of each other, that we bring out the qualities that actually work in harmony,
yeah,
in peace. And if we were doing so much of that that we love, I've said this over and over, and I really want to drive this home. If you really know your genius talent, if you really understand that you are a genius, we look at people like Van Gogh and we look at people like Elvis Presley, so they were gifted.
Yeah.
No, they listened inside to that calling that said, this is who I am. And all of the trials and tribulations that they had to go through to become who they were.
Right.
This is where many of us fall short. God is the all in the everything. The context is here. Within that context is a content that has everything that you need to create what it is that you desire. People ask me questions like that, you know, they say, well, so how come you're not perfectly healthy? And I said, I've met many masters. I don't know any of them that were perfectly healthy. We're human.
Yes.
And we've got things to go through. Yes, in this creative process, we created some muck in our lives. Mm-hmm. Okay? And it takes some unmucking to get it done.
I believe that. Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. And so we have to work at it a bit.
Right.
That's why, and when I do healing work, it's so much easier to work on children. They haven't been mucked up so much by our belief systems. They touch, you know, they touch this flower and the flower touches them back.
Yeah.
This is what they know.
Yeah.
It's not right or wrong or good or bad. It just is. And yeah. Kids are like that.
Yeah.
And you might notice when they speak, they're not speaking from their head. Hi, I love you. It's that they're speaking with their whole bodies, right? And when they don't want to do anything, they're resisting with their whole bodies,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
They're 100%. Lined up in creativity. Now, I didn't hear the word God or goddess or he, she, all that is. It's just, as a matter of fact, I've been in several ceremonies over the past few months marrying these two energies. We have separated them with thinking. And we're bringing them back together with knowing.
Right.
And now, so a woman and the female energy, the wisdom gets the knowledge and has the male energy balance, the yin and the yang, to go out and do the actual work. And the man has the wisdom to collect the knowledge, go out and do the actual work. This comes into balance. We all come into balance. That's mm-hmm. a beautiful time in the world.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful time to be alive because we're going to be creating this balance where when we can treat each other as equals, yeah, Imagine that.
Yeah, imagine that.
Okay.
Yeah.
When we can see each other as just other humans and not male, female, child, adult, this, that, but just other people of wisdom, mm-hmm. other people of knowledge, if we're God and we're creating, well, we're part of God, and as such, children of God or children of God and part of God, these are metaphors for we're part of the all and the everything.
Yeah.
And if we would like to be unrestricted in this manner, we have to allow other people their genius. George Gurdjieff says, wow, we're going to celebrate our idiocy once a month. We'll all be idiots. Okay. And if you look up the definition of idiot, it actually means to be all that you are.
Okay.
You could be a businessman, a father, a carpenter, a joker, a jester. You can be the guy that takes out the trash, and you're still the same person.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
But you're fulfilling all of these different roles.
Mm-hmm.
It's just science.
Mm-hmm.
Our brain does not know the difference between our imagination and what actually happened.
Mm-hmm.
Some people that have really lucid dreams think those things actually happen.
Yes.
It's not that they're going crazy. It's just the brain doesn't know the difference. Okay?
Yeah.
And this is what people call the illusion. So, oh, we're living in illusion. I beg to differ. We're living in a reality right now.
Mm-hmm.
What we make up about the past becomes the illusion. Now, here's the power in that. You want to talk about creation right now and how we can create miracles? You have a situation in your life that maybe was very traumatic and very difficult to deal with, and you made up something about that situation. You also made up something about yourself regarding that situation.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say it was a car accident or something, or somebody walking across the street, and you could have stopped them. In fact, you maybe really couldn't have, but you made up to yourself, I'm unworthy, I should have stepped forward. And later you're in a job interview, and you go to interview, and you sabotage it because you're unworthy.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
This is how these things work. It's called an implant, and that's actually creation.
Mm-hmm.
So every one of our thoughts, I read this in a, I found this in a book about a monastery, every one of your thoughts creates a whole new universe. Every one of our thoughts creates a new universe.
Yeah.
That's why we need to be mindful of what we're creating.
Right.
Of the miracles that we're creating. Miracle can be we created this horrible event or we created this lovely event.
Yeah.
The miracle is the creation. So often I think sometimes, why? Why am I doing this? Why is it so important for me for people to learn ancient knowledge? What do I gain from this? I really do think that we all should have a right to a beautiful life. Our definitions are all different. Beauty is certainly in the eye of the beholder. I remember a while ago I was working with some people who were sent home to die. And I'd worked with them for a while, and I realized about 2 years into it that they were still with me. And I was so flushed, I lost what I was saying. I was up on stage talking to them, and I just couldn't figure out what I was talking about. And then I realized, I saw them there laughing and enjoying their lives, where before they couldn't lift their heads or move. And I realized how joyful I was, how completely excited I felt when these people who came to me and couldn't lift their heads are now playing badminton in the backyard, walking out with me to the front door. It was my joy, it was my passion, this is my purpose. I was so blessed to find it. I suppose, looking back, I would have never found this path hadn't it been for my wife's transition. I was building homes. I was happy. I was in this voraciously beautiful material world. I was aspiring to greatness and great fortune. And when I found out that she had very little time to live, my whole world crashed. Everything changed. This took me on a journey that I'm so happy that I took, that I would wish for all of you, without, of course, the pain. What I'd really like you to know is that my journey came through a time during the change of the ages. We've left the Piscean Age, we've gone into the Age of Aquarius. And we're fully in that age now. We've gone through the 100-year cusp. And a new energy is about to take hold on Earth. This old energy was about pain and suffering, was about emotions, sacrifice. This new age is about knowledge and wisdom. And I've been blessed to be on that journey with the news of my wife that sent me around the world. I began, instead of laughing at gurus and people, adepts, avatars, however you want to call them, I was very skeptical about all that because I couldn't see it, feel it, taste it, or touch it. I really want you all to know that there's a whole nother world out there. The creative power that you have within you. And I discovered that creative power. It wasn't until I discovered that, for example, you could heal with your mind, that my whole life began to change. That this ancient knowledge that is embedded in all of us is there waiting for you. We only need to be quiet enough and to learn the tools to keep us on this track of knowing. In fact, we have to unlearn what we've learned in this modern day and age. And I'm not saying unlearn all of it, but we need to unlearn what we've been taught. We've been taught that if we want to be healed, if we want to get better, we need to look out to somebody else to do that. Well, indeed, if that's their genius, talent, and that's their power, then that's okay. People can help us a certain amount of the way, but what we really have to do is help ourselves. What we really need to do is to know that this healing quality is within each and every one of us. It is the genius creative power that we all have. It's the same power, if you would stop and listen, that would tell you if you're on the right path, the path that you came here to live. It's not so much that you have to be some great scholar or painter or entertainer or Nobel Peace Prize winner. All these are wonderful and great things. But for example, if your genius trait is compassion, and you bring compassion to the world in everything that you do, that alone could be your purpose. The thing that I would tell you the most, the idea that I'd like to live here with, is that there is a genius talent within each and every one of us. We are all equals in this respect, and we are all one. It's up to you to stop running here and there. If you really want to find all of the answers in this vast universe, you need only look into your own heart. You'll find everything that you need. So the biggest thing that I think is so important for all of us is to find what brings you joy and do that. If you do that, you'll never work another day of your life. I was very fortunate.
I became a carpenter. That was my joy. I built homes. Now I've become a master healer. And I build people's lives back together. Both of those gave me so much joy. Find out what brings you joy. It's not as hard as you think.
Hi, I'm Dr. Madhvish, metaphysical practitioner, light body activator, spiritual advisor, medicine woman, and author of You're Not Crazy, You're Awakening. Gregory and I have known each other now probably some 7 or 8 years, and I remember the first time that we met. It was at a spiritual center, and we crossed paths in the middle of a hallway, and Gregory stopped me, as kind and loving as he is, and said to me, and this was our first meeting, our first encounter, he said, you know, your throat chakra is shut down. It's supposed to be blue and open. And we stood there. I looked at him. He did his magic and it opened and it hasn't shut down since. And so that was our first encounter. And what was to become a beautiful relationship over these past few years. As my work, he, I would have to say, is who practitioners go to. So he's a practitioner's practitioner amongst so many other things. But our experiences together are nothing short of phenomenal and miraculous. Oftentimes I find myself needing to call him to get anchored and grounded and to pull me back in from beyond, beyond. In the work that I do, I'm often out in the cosmos. And so he can feel it, know it, and assist in bringing me back, helping me to anchor, helping me to stay grounded, to do my work here. And so he is invaluable to what I do. And I'm sure that he is invaluable to so many, as this truly is the time that we've been waiting for, and he, along with some others, are those who are here to do some amazing work. So it's with the most love and the deepest appreciation that I say, thank you, Gregory Joseph, for being in my life. Thank you for assisting me on my path, on my journey, as you do so many. Be well.
And when I came to this house, I met him, and it was the best that it happened to me. Because I have a girl, her name is Victoria. When she was born with a dislocated hip, so they need to do a surgery. When she was around 6 months, and she was in a cast almost for 2 years. And that's when I met them. And, you know, I was having a conversation with him, and I didn't know he was a healer. So it was just a normal conversation about my life. And I explained to him that my baby has to have another surgery. So when he started, you know, praying for her or talking, and it hit my heart. And I start crying because I feel his energy. And I never feel that way, only when I go to church. But when he started talking and, you know, I feel this peace in my heart, and I was crying like a baby, and everything that he said, it hit me, and I don't know, we connect each other. And I was, of course, I mentioned all my family, but everything was for Victoria. And every time we meet and we were here, he was always have her and her praise and her praise. And I took her, she's in, I have to go to the orthopedic doctor like every 3 or 4 months, and they take x-rays. And I can see the pictures that her hip was really dislocated. With the first surgery, it worked, but I mean, they needed to do a second one. So I took her back and they did x-rays, MRIs and everything. For my baby, she was 2 at that time. Imagine how much radiation that was given her. So we went to the doctor again, and he said she doesn't need another surgery. And I believe in my heart, and I know that it was because he was helping her. And I don't have the words to say thank you to him. I mean, he's an amazing person. I'm very lucky to have him in my life. I didn't believe it, but it works. I mean, I am so happy and blessed, and I really appreciate him a lot.
One of the things I'd really like to talk to you about is the demystifying healing. What is the essence of healing? How does this occur? How do we even know that we could do it? Well, maybe we could ask a different question first. How is it that we create illness? Given the natural state of being is healthy, almost all the time, I mean, it's rare that people are born ill, but it does happen. There's certain karmic reasons for that, but that's not for this conversation. The essence of healing. What's the essence of illness? Well, if we spend our time in negativity, if we use our language against ourselves, we're actually arranging a molecular structure within our bodies that responds to these actual commands that we're giving to our bodies from our brain. We're giving these commands from our brain to our bodies. Simple statements we are careless about. I'm sick of this. That's a pain in the neck. This is killing me. I'm going to die from this. These simple, innocuous statements create illness. They set something in motion inside you that you really don't want to set in motion. The essence of healing, then, is to change that frame of mind, to speak impeccably about yourself, to say, instead of this is killing me, saying, this unpleasant situation needs to be changed. We begin to take a different mindset about what it is that we want to create in our own bodies. We constantly uplift, uphold, and speak well of ourselves. Instead of walking by the mirror and saying, you're fat, saying, ah, I see you might want to lose a little weight to get more healthy. Let's say you're getting skinnier. Now, people will say, let's go ahead and talk about, say I'm healthy when I'm not. Well, that sets even a worse thing in motion, because it knows, you know inside you're lying somewhere. So instead of saying I'm healthy, you could say I'm healing myself now. This is a simple essence of healing. To focus all of your thoughts, your aspirations, your body, your mind, your spirit in a positive nature. This doesn't mean that you completely ignore anything that's negative around you. It's good to know that it's there. But why not use that as the turning point and say, oh, I see that's negative thought. I see that when I said that, I felt bad. I noticed that my energy went down when I said I'm sick of this, and change it. This is how healing happens. This is the essence of healing. This is what sets a whole new way of being from the central core of your bones to the outer limits of your own particular universe. You set out a different vibration into your body. And that vibration, you might notice when people are joyful and happy, they have a lot more energy when people are sad or miserable. And energy creates energy. Now, putting a lot of these different things together here, so that you could understand there's not just one road to this. You don't just pick one and say, okay, I'm going to do this and practice it and recite it and not really believe it. You've got to hit on one that works for you. And the only way you're going to do that is to keep checking, to find the tools that work. This is one of the reasons I'd really like to do this documentary. This is why I'm here. I'd like to show you some of those tools. I'd like you to know that they're even available. And once you learn this, you begin to heal yourself. You begin to do things naturally that work. So if I say I'm going to lose weight, well, I may be adjusting what I eat. People say, well, yeah, that's how you did it. Well, yes, it is, but I didn't have the impetus to do that until I decided that I'm going to do something in favor of my own health. Now, once I've decided and made that commitment, then it will work. But if I don't decide it and make the commitment, it won't work. So walking around saying, oh, I'm ill, doesn't work. But walking around and saying, I notice I have this symptom, it's time for me to do something about it. One of the really important things that I want you to know is that healing is about knowledge. It isn't that you have to be some ancient master to do this, although you could visit these ancient masters like I did to obtain the knowledge. There are many people like me that have obtained this knowledge from these people and are passing it to you. It's not some mystified woo-woo thing out there in the etheric. This is actual knowledge that works. It's just about learning the tools. You must learn the tools. You must obtain the knowledge to heal. Just like if you want to lose weight, well, then you achieve a certain diet and you follow those rules and regulations. If you want to release yourself from some debilitating disease or depression or anxiety, anything of this nature, you've got to know the tools and you can learn them. It's about knowledge. It isn't about some etheric thing that only the adept know how to do. The genius to heal is within each and every one of us.
It's not the first time that I've had a connection with Greg, but today was a real intense learning experience. And when we were getting towards the end, he said something that I'd actually never heard before. He said, you have to realize I am my own Warden Master. And when he said that, it was like the entire universe like came through so thick. I mean, I was kind of amazed, and I told him that. But later, he was saying the same thing. I am my own Lord and Master. But when he said it, he channeled God, and I was so stunned that I was like stunned in silence. I couldn't say anything for a good few minutes, and I said, "Do you know what you just did?" And I told him that he had channeled God years ago. I used to install alarm systems, and I was out of state, and I was having a very uneventful afternoon. So I decided, because it was warm, I'd lay outside in the sun for a while. And I was comparing, I guess they were kind of like metaphysical things, good things about the universe and stuff. And you know, saying this is good. And all of a sudden my chest began to heave, like I was laughing, you know, just laughing deeply. And I heard a voice that said, but there is only love. And I was like really shocked. But the thing was, is that was the same voice that came through Greg. And that's why I was kind of stunned. I knew that voice. I knew that energy. Greg had zeroed in on when I was 23, and I didn't realize that I was that young. And there were a whole lot of events that happened, very devastating events. And I was starting to get a little sad, and then all of a sudden it was like, whoa, wait. What is the lesson here? Greg kept saying, what is the lesson? And all of these events, which were about a divorce, his family reaction to me, which was not good, being a single parent the devastation of that kind of left me really, really hurt. But the lesson was, none of it had anything to do with me.
See, everything in your life, every event is preceded by a thought. And you've had some pretty tough thoughts over the years. Now they're gone. Okay?
Yeah.
And you could thank yourself for that. And anytime one of those thoughts sneaks up on you in a different form, I forgive myself.
That's the thing I didn't write down.
Sit in front of the mirror. You put aside 1 full hour. And you look into your third eye. You go completely inside yourself. You look right smack into your own third eye. And you pay attention to yourself for 30 minutes. You say, I forgive myself, with your left hand over your heart. You can look at your family and go, my, how you've changed since I've changed.
How different you are since I've changed.
Because when you're changed, your life, your perception of them will be different. Because you've changed your entire perception of yourself. And that clouded everything before. Now you're clear.
Oh, yeah.
Misty?
Yeah.
Excellent.
Hello. My name is Alexis Flo Leyva, coming to you from the Sacred Valley of Peru. And I'm founder of Spirit Quest, which are transformational retreats. I call Gregory the walking chalice because he's this embodiment of so much love and healing and insight. It's like this bottomless well of high vibrational spirit and contribution. I've been fortunate enough to work with Gregory on and off for 3 years. And the first thing I gotta say is that the man is heart-centered, as heart-centered and loving as they come. And he is just wired to heal and to make a difference and to expand what's possible for you. I myself, having gone into sessions with him, have found him to be incredibly insightful. And the reason I work with him is because I don't have his superpowers. And he's able to get to the root, to the genesis moment of issues. And specifically with me, it was around trust of females. And I've let fear design a lot of my romantic relationships and even intimate friendships. I've let the fear of being hurt sabotage what's possible in relationships. And working with Gregory, aka Gregorio, has allowed me to get to the root cause of those sabotage fear design mechanisms, leaving me so much more free to take risks, to get out of my comfort zone, to speak my truth, and to understand that, yes, maybe every relationship isn't going to last for forever, and I will be disappointed in relationships because we're all human. And yet that is not a reason for me to sabotage the joy, the intimacy, the connection, the possibility of being 100% committed and engaged in the relationships I'm in. It's the joy, it's the love, it's the deep commitment, it's the years and years and years and years of experience. And he's had to go through his own initiations, his own dark passages, and has come out a stronger, more compassionate, loving man. And you will not meet anyone deeper and more heart-centered than Gregory. I love you so much, brother. Thank you for the blessings you've bestowed on me and the healing. And thank you for your kindness and your friendship.
While in the middle of filming this documentary, we also witnessed the unexpected healing of a newborn baby from a distance who was in intensive care.
Jefferson, bright light, so tiny like the head of a pin at the center of this beautiful chamber in our hearts. And we double that light in size now and double it again until it fills our entire hearts. We double that light again, and again it fills our entire chest cavity. We double that light again, and we feel the pressure as it bursts from our heart chakra, joins all four of our heart's lights together in a beautiful white light, pulsating, vibrating, spinning all at the same time just above our heads. And that white light now goes up into the heavens, all the way in to the beautiful space around Earth. This beautiful white light doubles in size and doubles in size and doubles in size again, as though we can see it from here, the size of the moon. We see beautiful electromagnetic frequencies pouring into this beautiful white light, the energy, the pure, unconditional energy of the universe. Adding to the pulsing, the spinning, the vibrating of this beautiful white light as we send it now directly over baby Kayem. Our higher selves know exactly where she is now. And that beautiful white light now begins to descend over baby Kayem. And as it descends, it turns into gold. A beautiful gold vibration, the highest healing vibration known. This beautiful sphere of golden light descends closer to baby Cayenne, and now this beautiful gold light turns into the Divine Mother. She is completely gold, her hands facing downwards, her palm forward, her fingers slightly splayed, and beautiful golden waves of light pouring down over baby Cayenne. And we simply leave a message for baby Cayenne. We say, perfect this situation now, out loud.
Perfect this situation now.
And let it go. And so it is. Amen.
So many things in our lives are happening so quickly. We're distracted with many things to do. Madison Avenue tells us how to dress, how to act, how to think, how to smell, even how to talk to each other. When I received a call from Roger saying he'd like to do this documentary, before I thought about it, the word fell out of my mouth, yes. Yes, let's do this. And I was surprised. I thought, oh boy, what did I do? I'm really not prepared to do a documentary. Let's just say yes anyway. And then I got thinking about it. Why would I do this documentary? And I thought about all of the people whose lives have been improved through this journey and how much my life has been improved. There's a saying, the natural state of being is healthy. Anything beyond that we create. And when I discovered some of these little truths, and discovered also that most people didn't know about them, I saw my loved ones suffering. And it wasn't acceptable. I began working with friends, with family, and then with more friends, and then with strangers. I discovered we weren't strangers. Most of these people are my friends today. This kind of work, letting people know that you could heal with your mind, that the power to heal within you is so very important. That there is a genius inside you, that you have a talent. The talent may be as subtle as you're very peaceful, or you're compassionate, or you have a capability of understanding beyond others, or you maybe have an inventive mind, or your ability to make people laugh and have fun and enjoy their lives. We go rushing around looking for our purpose when we may already be living it. Why did I do this?
to let you know that you're perfect, just the way you are, that your purpose shines through your heart. I would like you to know that it's not that hard to find your heart. We talk about our brain as a separate entity from our heart. It isn't. It's all part of our heart. It's all part of our entire body. Our entire mind is our entire body, not just our brain. Our brain's just a part of it. And what I'd really also like you to know is that our bodies don't stop at our skin. We're part of a universal structure called oneness. And when we can embrace this oneness, we can understand that, for example, I am the consciousness of you that is, that always was, that always knew. And that makes me, in some respects, you. So if I should treat you with compassion, with respect, then I'm actually respecting and being compassionate to myself. When we understand this concept, when you understand it, when I understand it, when we live our lives in competition with ourselves to be the very best that we could be, doing the very thing that we love to do, I'm sure that we would all find such joy in our lives that we would find the time to be in support, in service of each other, in selfless service with our own gifts. There's a saying, of course, that the gift is in the giving. And this works with a beautiful concept that love is an outward centrifugal force. Don't you feel loving when you're giving? Isn't it a beautiful feeling? If we could do this in most of our lives, if we could just love ourselves and be in service to others, we would have a beautiful world to live in. I see a world with no locks or chains, with no boundaries or borders or people fighting over who's right or wrong, or good or bad, but going about their way, serving with all of the joy in their heart, knowing that's what they are here for. If I could leave this message with you, if you could find your way to your heart, you will find the genius within you. And when you find that, you'll be doing what you love. And I think when you find that, that'll bring great joy to you. And the vibration of joy is very powerful. It will affect many people in your lives. I really appreciate you being here, taking the time to see what this is all about. It's really all about you. I hope you've enjoyed it.